Welcome to the Startup Grind.
Who has excelled to the level where these schools is declared successful. Ranging from graduates to extracurricular activities, college has set its benchmark and with the same mindset, Equinox, the entrepreneurship club of NMIMS, is hosting this event with Startup Crunch. So I would now request Swati to present the bouquet to Mr. Vipul Parekh.
Thank you. Please be seated. First of all, thank you very much, Vipul, for taking your time for us. So let's start from where you have started. Probably if you can tell us something about your education, about your work experiences before your entrepreneurial journey. So that would help us to understand about more about you.
Okay. I have this very weird career graph. I've done multiple things, and all for illogical reasons at various times in my life. So I actually did my master's in physics, and I was all set to become a research scholar in physics. And I was actually set to join the University of Chicago. And then one fine day, sort of, I got a brainwave saying, what's the point in doing research in physics? And there are only most large research scholars then were working on very esoteric problems. And I said, these really don't have any significant application to mankind, or they don't really excite me. And I didn't want to get into solving really weird problems which most people have never heard of. So I said, what's the alternate career graph for me? So I said, the best thing that seems to be, if I look at the Indian context, is to become a manager. Let's do an MBA. So I actually sat for the CAT, got through by some fluke, and joined IIM Bangalore. So I was a physics research scholar who had done his MPhil in physics. And I did my master's and then did my MPhil. And I was a gold medalist in that. And went and became a manager with no idea about what an MBA was. So I spent about 2 years at IIM Bangalore. I think it was for me it was a complete eye-opener. One, I think the quality of people that I was studying with was very, very different from what I had seen before. Second, the kind of quality of faculty that you had was absolutely inspirational. And there was a lot of weird stuff going around. People were doing all sorts of stuff which interested them. And to me that was quite inspiring. And I said, this is what I really signed up for. So I had a nice, eventful 2 years in IIM Bangalore and passed out in way back in 1988. And then decided, let's join the IT industry. Paradoxically, I'd done all my courses in finance. And most of my courses were in finance and some of them in marketing. So I had this weird blend of physics, finance, and marketing. And I landed up in an IT company, and which was completely different again. So, and that too, the company that I joined, this was TVS Electronics in those days, it was again a startup. And so for me, the reason I chose a smaller company was I thought it would be great, much greater fun, and learn. I realized that it would most of the time actually be a major pain. So I did this physics, finance, marketing mix, and my first job was in sales. And I didn't know an invoice from a delivery chalan, and I didn't know what sales meant. And the company posted me to start the Bombay office. There was nobody in the Bombay office. I was the only person. And they had supplied to some large customers there, and they're supposed to go and they still owed money and they're not paid. So my first job was really going around in Bombay, going after all these old bandicoots who were refusing to pay. And so that was a great experience, because whatever I did, they refused to pay. And it was a very humbling experience. I would spend hours outside their office waiting. You think you're from IIM Bangalore, you're a great guy in life, and you're sitting there outside, even the chowkidar does not give you the time of the day. So it was a very humbling experience, and I think it taught me a lot of lessons which have remained with me ever since. One, I think it's great to have a stint in sales. It's nothing to bring your ego down to ground level and keep it there for the rest of your life. Second, I think it teaches you about people. How important it is, irrespective of what you do and whichever discipline you're in, how do you work around people? How do you get people to empathize with you? How do you get your work done through people? And I learned the hard way. And I made a lot of mistakes. I used to lose my temper initially, saying, how can you keep me waiting for so long? I said, don't come here for the next 2 months. So I quickly learned, you can't lose your temper, right? And you can't throw your weight around. And then therefore, I realized, you need to build your relationships. And over a period of time, some of those guys who I used to find it difficult to collect became good friends. And I could actually call them and say, please send the money, and they would send it. And they would keep other people waiting when I went there. And I saw that happening. So I realized, it was so important to build those relationships, how important people were. So did my first 5 years in TVS Electronics, then joined Wipro, worked with them. And again, did a career switch in Wipro. I started in marketing, and then said, this is, I wanted to do something else. So I went to my boss one fine day and said, I want to move out of, I was working in the peripherals division. I said, I want to move to the another role. Can you tell me what else is possible? Because I've done this enough and I don't want to do marketing anymore. So he said, there are no roles, but if you want, you can join. There is one, role, which is a business development role, but it basically means you'll do everything. So I said, I don't mind doing it. So it was a very interesting role, as it turned out. So I was sort of called business development manager. And it meant, in charge of everything that nobody else will touch. And that was essentially the development role. So I was doing, and I was reporting to vice chairman of the Wipro, then Arun Tyagarajan. So I was doing, on one hand, I was sitting into Wipro board meetings with Premji and the entire corporate people. The other hand, I was trying to figure out what to do for the internet strategy for Wipro. How should they go about developing an intranet? How should they actually, what should they communicate to customers as regards to their strategy? On the third, I was trying to figure out what acquisitions should Wipro do in services so that will make them, which will be viable in the long run. So it was one absolutely smorgasbord of unconnected, unrelated stuff. And that was very good. I really enjoyed it. Because, it exposed me to stuff which I never have seen otherwise. So on one hand, you were discussing, corporate strategy with somebody like Jeffrey State, and the other hand, you were trying to figure out with a young guy saying, what should the, the intranet portal for Wipro look like? And then talking to, companies outside the country, trying to figure out what kind of terms, how do you structure a relationship, how acquisitions are made possible, is there a merger to be done. So it was really a great learning experience, and I really thoroughly enjoyed that. And that sort of, I think, really started me on this entire entrepreneurship journey. And around 99, so I and a couple of my colleagues from the time I started working in TVS Electronics decided that we'll start a business. We started a company called Fabmart.com. Most of you have not heard of it now. It was one of the largest and the earliest horizontal that you would see. A lot like what Flipkart is today, except this was 1999 and dial-up days. And so therefore there was a very limited set of people, and we were way ahead of the curve. But there was this huge dot-com frenzy going on. So we got funded very quickly. We had some very illustrious investors. Our first investor was actually Reliance Industries. And that's how we got to know Mukesh Ambani and Manoj Modi and all that. Manoj Modi was actually the first chairman of Fabmart. And then we got funded by Chris Capital, one of the largest private equity companies in the country. And all of it went down the tube 2 years later. And that was a lesson. And you saw how difficult it was to build a business when the market was not right. You saw how easily you could get funded, even when there was no market. And how quickly it could all disappear. After all that, you thought it was a great business. And so when that happened, I think the good thing that happened was we were all fairly seasoned guys. And we did not come with huge expectations into the business. So we said, let's see, what's the opportunity? And we're not getting funded in online business anymore. There are not enough customers. It's going to take a long time to build an online business. Let's do something else. So we actually started, as part of online, we'd done grocery before. So we said, let's look at the grocery space. And we looked at physical retail and said, there's only one large physical grocery chain in the country, which is Food World. You didn't have Reliance Fresh, you never had More, you didn't have Electricity, you didn't have any of the Spencer's. What was Food World? So we said, that looks like a good idea. Why don't we start stores? So we started physical grocery stores. And remember where we are, physics. Finance, marketing, and doing strategy for Wipro and tech, and then you're selling dal, chawal, atta, sabji. So that's how, we transformed to actually setting up stores, and we learned the business. There was nobody to hire who knew what physical retail was in the country in those days. So we learned the entire business from the ground up. And one of the enduring lessons I've learned is that you can learn anything. So that stayed with us. And so we learned the entire business, built that business out, actually acquired a larger business out of Andhra Pradesh called Trinetra, built that entire business and sold it to the Villas in late 2006. And so that was a good 6-7 years that we spent building out a grocery business. And that contributed to a lot of learning in the grocery space and also in general about building a company. When we sold it, it was about 400-500 crore company, profitable, 10,000 people on the rolls, and we were across the entire South. And so that was a good learning, I mean, building a business like that from scratch. Then went back and then I said, you know, when we sold this business, I said, I don't want to continue with it anymore. I was very clear, saying once you've got out of it, there's no point in continuing with it. And I was a loose end, so I said, let me try things from the other side of the table. So I joined a private equity firm and worked with them, understanding what and driving investments and understanding what, how do you invest and what do you look for when you invest for the long term. What drives you? How do you raise money? How do you raise money for a private equity firm, not for a company? And it's a completely different ballgame. How do you project? What do you look for in entrepreneurs? What are the macro trends that you need to watch out for when you're doing investing of this sort? So it was an interesting 3 years that I spent there. And then in about 2011, we decided let's go back to grocery. And so the entire team that we've been together for a long time said, you know, let's restart. And we started Big Basket in 2011 in Bangalore, and we've gone through 2-3 rounds of funding subsequently. And the business is scaling up nicely. We're in 3 cities, still a long way to go, still early days. My guess is we still have about 6 or 7 years to go before the business really achieves true potential. So we are on an early cusp of what promises to be a long and interesting journey. So that sort of gives you an overview of all the weird stuff that happens. And a lot of it has happened by, you know, taking impulsive gut feel decisions when the opportunity presents themselves. And that's something I've realized, you know, at times you need to trust your gut. You need to take the calls which you think seem right. And no amount of analytical decision making, doing pros, cons, making Excel sheets with all of that helps. You just need to take those calls and move on and make the best of them. And as long as you're sane about it, you will do well.
Sure. Thank you very much for that inspiring journey.
Long-winded introduction. Thank you.
So we spoke about physics, electronics, and your shopping and all those things. But there is something about the chemistry between your founders, amongst your founders. So we have Abhinay, Sudhakar, Hari Menon, and Rameshi from Rock. Please correct me. So this is the same founding team who had built Fabmon. I think the same team came forward and building Big Basket now. So how is the chemistry of, among your co-founders? How did you guys meet? Because that will really help us, because a lot of people here would be doing business alone. So they are not clear about their, how to find out the right co-founder.
I think co-founders is a bit of
luck.
I think
co-founders
is a bit of chemistry.
Yeah.
And I think that's what it really works out. You need to be comfortable with the people that you work with, and I think it's extremely important. So I'll tell you some of the things that we did. You know, incidentally, let me give you a little background of Hari and Sudhakar. Three of us go back a long ways. Sudhakar was actually my first boss when I started working. And Hari was my colleague. And that's how we knew each other. But over the last 25 years, we probably worked 20 years together, by choice. And not because we were forced to by some people. And I think that's happened primarily because a good relationship is built on multiple things. One, it's built on trust. One, it's built on a shared culture. And I think a lot of time people underestimate how important culture is. That is. What do you mean by culture? Culture is what's your attitude to life. You know, are you, what's your, you know, how do you spend your money? How do you, you know, lead your life? I mean, how ostentatious are you? What drive motivates you in life? Those things are very, very important. And those soft factors are very important in aligning co-founders. Building a startup is a very arduous journey. And you go through really painful times, and therefore it requires that trust and that shared culture for it to work. So when we did the first startup, one of the ground rules we made when we started up in 99 was, we said, it doesn't matter what happens to this business, we are not in it for the money. And if you walk out with just our shirts on our back, we'll be very happy. And that we communicated to all our initial team. We said, you know, don't have any expectations of getting away with it, but, you know, building a wealth in this. This is just an experience, it's just for learning. And if you make some money out of it, well and good. If you don't, great. You might be off to a good experience. And so the moment you do that, I think that lays the foundation. You're much more sane when it comes to difficult issues like, are we going to survive the next day or not? And you're faced with those situations multiple times. So lots of times when we ran out of money, we didn't know when we were, how we were going to pay salaries. We didn't pay ourselves any salaries for 6 months at a stretch. So you get to, through those situations only by if you have a shared value, if you have a shared commitment, and you're able to work with each other. And that happens, and the important thing is that you need to be able to respect the person. So don't make somebody a co-founder because he's your good friend. You may get along well for an evening out, and he may be great company, but that doesn't necessarily mean he'll get a great co-founder. You need to be somebody whom you respect professionally. Because it's important to disagree. And when you're in a startup, three of us fight all the time. You'll be amazed if you go get into one of our internal meetings, you realize you think these guys actually hate each other. Right? And we are at complete variance at times. And we really battle it out. And that's one of the reasons why we stayed together so long. And that's one of the reasons why we don't need to opinion. You do all the fights, settle on something and move on and forget about it the next day. And you restart again. So you start the new fight the next day. And I think that happens all the time. That ensures that you have creativity, that ensures that you have disagreements, so therefore somebody is not unilaterally deciding what is right. And that builds a much, much stronger thesis all in all. So it's important to have that kind of chemistry. Make sure, so therefore the one thing I would, if you're looking for a co-founder and if you're not somebody whom you know well, look for shared values. And I think that is more important than anything else. And if you look for shared values and general attitude to life, I think you'll find that that's probably the best way to select a co-founder, more than anything else.
Wonderful. So let's talk about bigbasket.com. We have been hearing about bigbasket every year and there. So we have been hearing about the ads and we have been seeing the hoardings around. So as a business, probably it would be really nice if you can help us in understanding some technology aspects of bigbasket. Probably what is the tech? I mean, how is the technology used and how is it usable as a business?
One of the interesting things about technology is, when we started bigbasket, we said we'll do three things. One, we will do what has been done worldwide at 1/10 of the cost, 1/50 of the cost. We will actually do it more profitably than what has been done in physical retail or anywhere else in the world. Right? And we will use a fraction of the capital which has been deployed to build a similar size of business. So we set ourselves fairly large goals. And the idea of setting these goals is really, can we, if you do this three well, then you're able to use less money to build a more profitable business, right? And then obviously you're creating something which has substantial value. But before I talk about what we've done, I think it's important to step back and see what's so unique about grocery, or what's so complex about grocery that requires technology, that requires all sorts of work to really make it a feasible business. If you look at grocery, it's actually retail. It's extremely data driven and extremely technology driven today in the world. The largest, can you guess who's the largest investor in technology outside of the Pentagon? Pentagon, US Pentagon, which is US Defense Services. Who's the single largest?
Walmart
is the second largest investor in technology. And that's no fluke. It's a very deliberate because that's the kind of investment or involvement you need in technology to really make a business. And why do you need technology? Because when you're managing a business which is comprised of so many moving parts, you need to make sure that all the parts are, you have transparency, you're able to figure out what's working, you have data on what's working and not working, and you're able to correct things as they come in. And you have data on what's happening with customers, you're able to predict trends, you're able to figure out what's happening with customers, how are they buying, why are they buying, whether something is moving, not moving, and why is it moving, and figuring out stocks, and figuring out how to predict demand. All those become very important. And therefore, technology really goes into building a very strong backend or a foundation on which you can get business rights. The other thing about technology, and this I've learned having been in technology and sales and marketing and business, is that most people get awed by technology. If you take a non-tech person, and if you take MBAs with a finance and marketing background, and put a technology guy in front of them, and they assume that what it's saying is right. Most of the times, remember, technology is a slave to business, and it is a tool. It is not an independent business by itself. It is only a business enabler. So let me give you an analogy to get this right in your mind. Let's say you have to hire a transporter to move your goods. How will you go about it? You'll figure out what's the best transporter, you will evaluate, you know, who's the cheapest, who's the most reliable, who has excellent customers, whose customer feedback is good, and you go ahead and hire that, right? And then you figure out a new billing process, check whether it's delivering value. You have to do the same thing with technology. What happens in most companies is technology requires a life of its own. So you have this entire tech department and you have this tech team, and they're building this entire monster. And this is monster has an independent life, and in some places it will sort of you know, collide with the business, but most cases it's sort of survival and growing on its own. And what that means is that, you know, half of the time technology is driving business, or doing stuff which is not getting used in business at all. And this happens with large companies all the time. They have significant investments in technology, huge amount of technology output. If you go and ask the users, they don't know even half of it, or don't use half of it. So therefore, there is a significant amount of investment going on, which is not getting used. And that's a common phenomenon you find. And this is not just confined to India, this is across the world. You'll find that in large corporates, you'll find in e-commerce companies, you'll find in internet companies, you'll find in companies across the length and breadth. And the reason for that is that most business owners don't take responsibility for technology. Yes, somehow intimidated by it, so therefore they say, okay, let the CTO, let the IT guy decide what to do, and he will then figure out which is the best way to solve this problem. So therefore, how do you get this, tame this beast called technology? I think the important thing here is that you need to know that the moment you say technology is a tool, you decide how do I want to use it. So therefore, look at your business, look at what are the key things that you want to use technology for, and figure out whether technology can make a difference to that or not. So let me give you a more concrete example to figure this out. So let's look at our business. What is the key thing in our business? Our key thing in our business is when something is, our inventory has to be absolutely accurate. So today, we give all our customers what we call fill rate guarantee. What is the fill rate guarantee? If you place an order with me for let's say 50 items, and there is any item I don't deliver, if I don't deliver the item, I'll give you 50% of the item value as a credit rate. It's a very stupid thing to do. And in fact, when we talked about it the first time around, everybody said, you know, we should never do this because this will ruin us. This will bankrupt us. But you said, I think it's important to have a reverse penalty on the business, because that's the only way you will be focused on making sure that your fill rate is right. So to give you you know, some statistics, large online retailers, the best in class in the world, run at about 94%, 95%, 96%, 97%, between 94% to 97% fill rate in grocery and outside grocery. The grocery is more complex. So that's the fill rate. If you look at large physical stores, in the US would run at 91%, 92%, 93%. In India would run at anywhere from 85% to 90%. For example, if you take a list of, if I give you a list of 20 items and say which is what the store is supposed to carry, and you go and try to buy from that, you'll find that at least you'll be able to fill only about 90%, 95%. So the moment you say, I'll give you a guarantee of 50% of item value back, and suppose I operate at 90%, what is the cost to my business? You're all MBAs, do the math. I said the cost is 5% of GMV if I operate at 90% fill rate. If I operate at 80% fill rate, it's 10% of GMV. What is the total margin that the largest grocer like Reliance makes in India? 20%. So if you give 10% off because if you're not able to fill, or 5% off, you're out of business. And you can't, it's a debilitating cost. So why did we do this? The reason we did this was to realize that, you know, in an online business, the reason the person is coming to you is because he, you know, it's convenience. He wants everything to be delivered home. Now if you deliver only 3/4 of what he wants home, he has to still go out for the balance 1/4. Sometimes he's going to say, this doesn't make sense at all. If I'm going outside, let me just go outside and buy. Why should I buy from these guys? Right? Or he will do say, okay, let me pick up all the heavy stuff, buy from them. Everything else, let me just go outside and buy. So therefore, you are actually striking a blow at your own business. So that's the problem statement. So therefore, you need to deliver very high fill rates. And if you don't deliver those fill rates, you have a significant cost to the business. Significant cost to the business in terms of finance and in terms of customers moving out. Now, so therefore, how do you use technology to make sure that we deliver this? So now the problem that, so one way to solve this is, okay, carry as much stock as you can of everything. But the problem with the moment you carry large stocks is that you have larger expiry, you have damages, you have, you're paying for excess stock, your working capital gets locked up. So the other business problem that you have is you need to now make sure that your stock is optimal. So if I go to any investor today, he asks me, okay, what is the inventory? How many days of inventory do you carry? And what is the cost of carrying inventory? Because it's the first metric anybody will ask you. So therefore, you can't carry too much higher. Now, you're faced with two conflicting goals. You need to deliver very high metric rate, and you need to deliver, make sure that you can't carry too much. So the moment you have this, how do you solve for this problem? The only way you can solve for this problem is really by using technology. And without getting into too much detail, essentially what we do is, therefore, our entire ordering or stocking is determined by technology. So we have algorithms which calculate, what is the sales rate, what is the likely sales rate to be, what is the supplier efficiency, what is the supplier fill rate, how many times the supplier this thing, what is the seasonality of the product, and every time an order is placed, it determines what should be the order. And we get 10,000 SKUs on a rolling basis, therefore it computes the what should be carried. And this can't therefore be done manually. Imagine if I had people trying to buy 12,000 SKUs on a daily basis. You spend the full day just doing that and still not be able to place the order and to figure out whether it's right or not. So you can't even do it manually. Right? So it starts becoming an approximation if you do it manually. So therefore it has to be done by technology. The other side, and I didn't tell you another constraint in the problem is that your suppliers are not necessarily the most efficient. All the big FMCG brands that you know of, they're very poor at filling orders. They're great at marketing. And some of the most illustrious brand names fill 60-70% of an order that you place, which is ridiculous in my opinion. So therefore, on the other side, you have a very poor supply chain. And the 60% will keep changing. So I place an order on, let's say, Procter & Gamble, Kellogg's, Unilever, any of these guys, and the guy, I place an order for 100 items, he delivers 60. So now, I have the problem that I need to be accurate, take into account his inefficiency, figure out how I'm, and we are growing rapidly, so you figure growth, keep minimum stock, and still deliver to customer everything that he wants. And so this is the problem which cannot be solved by manual intervention. It has to be solved by technology. So this is where you define saying, okay, this is how, so we have built a system which really optimizes this, predicts what should be ordered and orders it. So the entire ordering and management of stock is actually done by technology. There's no human person involved. And this happens on a daily basis. So to give you a metric, we carry about 9 or 10 days of, say, stock. So we are in a negative working capital business. If you take a large physical retailer, they will carry between 45 to 60 days of stock. So we carry 1/10 of what they carry. So that's the efficiency that you can achieve when you start solving problems with technology. But that's on the stock part of it. On the fill rate, we run at 99.5% fill rate, which is why we are able to afford that. And so when you run at 99.5% fill rate, what you're not filling is 0.5%, so my cost to the business of that is 0.25%. And if I take my margin out, it's 0.2%. So the cost of giving that guarantee to me is about 0.2% of what our total cost is. And that's really the power of technology. And there's nobody in the world who delivers at that fill rate. Nobody. The largest physical growers in the world, $1 billion companies, don't deliver at those kinds of fill rates. And their investments in technology are about, to give you an example, there's a large online grocery business called Ocado in the UK. Runs at about $4.5 billion in sales, has spent about $500 to $600 million in terms of technology. And keep expanding this up. So which is roughly 1/3 of what the revenue is. We'll spend maybe 20th or 1/30th of what they spend to build a similar size business. So therefore, it's important that you know, it is possible to deliver world-class metrics. It is possible to be the best in the world. But the only way you can solve for this is technology. So, and technology comes in, and we use technology right through. So one of the things that we learned very early on, that technology has to be used in every aspect of the business where you can. Because if you don't, you can't be really efficient. See, the other place we use technology is our entire van routing, distribution of orders is actually done by, again, a lot. So for example, I get this 3,000 orders every day in Bangalore, and now if somebody has to, we deliver the same day. So if you place an order by 12 o'clock, we deliver by 5 o'clock. So now, and this has to go in, let's say, 150 vans. So therefore, these orders now need to be allocated to vans, right? And imagine somebody manually sitting and saying, okay, fine, this guy is going to Koramangala, so give him all the orders around Koramangala. So he'll run through the 3,000 orders to find out what are Koramangala orders and put it there. And you may realize that you need 5 vans in Koramangala, so okay, it's okay. Okay, first 20 of Koramangala, give it to him. First next 20 of Kurumla video might go this way. That's not efficient. It takes away a lot of time. And absolutely error prone. In our case, what happens is the system looks at this, as Google Maps knows what the distances are, knows what the travel times are based on this thing, picks clusters. So it decides what the clusters are. The system will automatically realize, okay, all these orders belong to Kurumla. Within Kurumla, these are the 10 clusters. And therefore, we can assign each of the vans to this cluster. And it will also calculate. Remember, the other challenge in our business is order sizes can vary. So my van has so much of capacity. Right? For us, an average van carries about 15, 16 orders it can carry. Now, you might get one order which is the size of an average of 4 or 5 orders. And one order which is only one. It's much lesser than the normal order van. So how do you optimize for this? So what could happen is either you leave your van empty, you say only 15. Or you will not, and you give the van 15 and you say, okay, I can fit only 3. What do I do with the balance 12? You leave it behind. So it also looks at the size of order, calculates how many crates will fit in, and then decides how many orders to order. All this happens instantaneously. So it decides the cluster, decides how many vans are required, decides which van should carry what, downloads all the orders to the van, downloads to that guy's delivery app, that gives him a map to the customer's door, tells him in which order to deliver. So therefore, and now all the vans are GPS tracked. So the system now knows, okay, when did the van leave, where is it, when is it delivered, and how much time does it take to deliver. So we actually give a guarantee on delivery to all our customers, saying if you don't deliver within the slot that you give me, we give you 10% of your order value back. Now the way that works is that the moment an order is not delivered on time, the customer doesn't call customer service. The system recognizes because it knows where the van is. It knows when the order was delivered because there is a geofence, there is a timestamp on every order. So it recognizes, okay, this order is outside time. And so therefore, a lot of times, the guy is 10 minutes late, but the moment the slot is over, the system will compute and credit the amount. So the credit for the late delayed order would have reached the customer's wallet even before the order does. So that's the point. So you have to use technology to make this efficient. There is no way you can run large, complex businesses without using technology. And we've done all this technology, and this is all proprietary, but we've done all this at a cost and a size of the technology team which astounds most people. So therefore, it is not issue. So let me come back to my original premise. It is not so much about putting 500 engineers and putting them to work to deliver this. It is about putting 100 business owners saying this is what the technology is to deliver and laying out the specs well. The moment you do that, you get a much better product. And you realize this works across business functions. You do the same thing with your advertising agency, you get a much better ad. Do the same thing with your technology team, you'll get a much better product. And if you don't do either, and if you don't, as a business owner, if you don't take that ownership and lay down those specs clearly and decide, and communicate them, you will get an iterative product which you'll keep, working on, trying to figure out how it works.
Thank you. So the reason all we know about bigbasket.com is because of the marketing efforts done from your team. So I understand that you personally handle the marketing department. So if you can touch upon the marketing, the startup or a marketing, a company which is growing, so what are the elements that we need to take care of while we're marketing something?
I actually handle marketing and finance, which is a very weird combination. So thanks to the kind of experience I've had, I'm able to do both. I don't know how long I'll be able to do both, but at least for the last 3 years I've done it, and I hope to do it at least for a year or two more. And so on one hand, I'm supposed not to spend money, on the other hand, I'm supposed to spend money. So it's a nice schizophrenic existence that I have in many places. But one of the things I realized that, and this is where you should focus on as a startup, is don't focus on marketing. Honestly, in fact, in BigBasket, for the first, 15 or 16 months of our existence, we hardly spent anything on marketing. And the reason for that is very simple. We said, let's create a great product and customers will come. And this happens again and again and again. If your product is not good, or if it does not have product market fit, and I'll talk about that maybe later, you can actually spend any amount on marketing, and people will come in from the store and walk out from that. And that is not a mechanism to build a business. And unless you can demonstrate that you can acquire customers without spending on marketing, then that's the only time that you know that you've built a business. So even today, 50 to 60% of our new customers, and we get about 20-25,000 new customers every month, have come because of word of mouth. Don't come from because of any marketing. Don't even use the first order discount or voucher that you give to new customers. And just come because somebody told them. And we've done check this consistently across customers, and they say, you know, my friend told me, you know, why don't you try this, good service, or this, I saw this van coming in this thing, and I said, you know, I must try this out, and it sounds very interesting. So we get a lot of, and customers telling customers, customers coming on the road. That's when you know that you have built a business or a service which customers like. And if you have to spend money to acquire initial customers, then you realize that you're in trouble. And if you continue spending it, then you know that it's a very difficult. Because if you look at the media costs in any country, anywhere in the world, media is priced such that you cannot acquire customers on a continuous basis for any business. Eventually, you need to build a self-sustaining business. So there is no way that you're going to be able to get away with spending. You can spend any amount. You can spend $1 billion, and you can spend through all of it and still not reach anywhere. So it's important to remember that. So don't worry too much about marketing when you're, and I'll talk about what you can do in marketing. But I think don't worry about marketing when you're getting started out. Worry about building a great product. Worry about focus on your user experience. In the first 24 months that we spent, our entire technology effort was not considered on the website, or figuring out what features to have, or whether what colors work. All that is very necessary in internet business. But he said, let's get our backend in place so that we are able to deliver this 99.5% fill rate, we are able to deliver 99.1% on time, and we are able to do it consistently day out of day. And this is in Indian traffic conditions with all the mess that we have on Bangalore roads, with rain and all that, you still deliver on time. When you are able to do that, then customers will automatically remain. And then you spend marketing to acquire customers, because at least those customers will remain with you. You build a good product, they'll have a great experience. Otherwise, people just, you know, if you see some of the cohorts and the retention rate, you know, rates of large sites, you'll be shocked. I have no idea how they'll ever stem that kind of bloodbath. Because if you spend, let's say, 2,000 rupees or 1,000 rupees to get a customer in, guy buys for, let's say, 10,000 rupees, right, and then disappears. Everything is bought for 10,000 rupees, I spent 1,000 bucks, great, I made 10% on it. Your first order, you lost -20%, it never comes back. So your costs of now that, so you're -1,000 rupees down on a customer which has come and gone. You have the top line. I don't know what you're going to do with it. You're going to find another way now. So this becomes a treadmill which you can't get out of the moment you get a business like that. Having said that, simple things to do when you are a startup, to get presence and to get acquire initial customers. Figure out where your initial customers are coming from and go after them, etc. Figure out who are your, see, every business has what are called low-hanging fruit. How large the segment is depends on, what kind of business you are in. So for example, our low-hanging fruit was very clearly double income, you know, working couples who don't have part of the time. Very clearly, if you look at the business, it is extremely convenient for them, and in modern day homes, the wife obviously does not want to go and spend, the husband doesn't even want to go anywhere near a grocery store. And so the wife says, why the hell should I go if you don't want to go? So nobody wants to go to the grocery store, and it's a headache to spend, Saturday, Sunday, spending time buying that stuff. So therefore, those are very clearly target segments. And he said, okay, fine, let's find out where do these target segments work, or how can I reach them most cost effectively? So we figured out the geographical concentration is Whitefield, and which is the most, concentrated on, and the other is this entire Sarjapur and Venkata Road there. And we really went after those two segments. So our entire marketing effort that we did initially was only focused on these two parts of the city. In the rest of the city, people did not have heard of us. And that was the case for a very long time. And that worked well for us because those customers came in very quickly, they stayed with us, because there was a genuine need for the service and they were desperate for it. And those customers did not even care whether I priced 10% above the market, though we were not. Because they are willing to pay the premium. For them, the value of the service is such that they don't care what the cost is. So you have to find that sweet spot. And then you figure out what is the most efficient way of going on the sweet spot. Most times, people think everybody is my customer. So let me just go and put an ad. It's the worst thing you can do. It's the most inefficient use of money is to put advertisements in newspapers and TV. And you can't do that unless you're reasonable size. So therefore, don't even think of going down that path. So therefore, figure out how are you going to find localized, easily accessible groups of customers who are the core constituency for your business, and go after them. And there are multiple ways to do that. So in our case, we figured out that the easiest way was to go to the large, companies like an Infosys or a Wipro or a Dell and say, we'll give you a special discount for your customers. Why don't you come with it? HR guys loved us and said, yes, we'll do that. So they are therefore communicating to their customers the entire way, saying that, no, why don't you? In many cases, they approach us. For example, in the case of Infosys, they call us and say, can you do something for employees who would like to promote this amongst an entire base? Okay. So I forget about customer acquisition costs. I have a negative customer acquisition cost. They are calling me and saying, please come and provide this. So when you recognize, so therefore it's important to find out these customer sites. And you'll find that the cost of approaching these customer sites is very, very little. And any startup can afford it. But the moment, you, and then when you build on it, then you acquire market funds, you go and do a broad marketing campaign. But till then, don't even dream of doing it.
Sure. Since you said you are handling finance as well, so let's talk about something other funding. So how did you start? I'm like, probably you would have started from the seed funding to the Series A funding and so on. So that also takes me to the question, and probably everyone has this question in mind, how to pitch and get funded?
Right. So let me take the second question first. Funding is very tricky. You need a little bit of luck. You always need luck. Being an entrepreneur, you realize one of the first things, most of the successful entrepreneurs that I've seen, if you ask them honestly, what contributed to success, they would say probably 50-60% luck. And being in the right place at the right time sometimes, just making the right things, a lot depends on circumstances which are outside your control. So you can accept that. And you should have the humility to understand that sometimes great ideas don't get funded, poor ideas do and disappear. And all that sort of stuff happens. And I think it's important to recognize that. But having said that, I'm also a firm believer in the adage that you create your own luck. And you create your own luck by actually doing multiple things. One, if you are an entrepreneur, first believe in your idea. Don't do, become an entrepreneur or start something when you're half-baked or when you're not really clearly thought it through. It's a long-term time commitment. If you want to become a successful entrepreneur, it takes 10 years. Please set aside 10 years of your life. It is not 1 or 2 years, 3 years, 4 years. Most people say 90% of startups fail. I say a lot of them fail because people don't have the stomach to last it out. I've seen 90% of startups fail because they don't last beyond the second or third day. And a lot of times they don't last because they don't have the heart for it. Not because they ran out of money. You run out of money, but you figure out a solution to that also. It's never because of that. So therefore, mentally you say, okay, fine, I'm going to give this time to it. Or I'm going to give 5 to 6 years, 7 years to it. The moment you do that, you'll be at peace with yourself. You'll also start planning on that basis. And you'll structure your life accordingly. So therefore, that's very important. So I think it's important to recognize that. The second thing is when you believe in an idea, it shows in you. I'll give you an example without taking names. Recently, about 2 weeks back, a couple of people approached me. Very interesting startup idea. And I thought it sounded very interesting, so I put them onto so I called this venture capital friend of mine, runs a large seed fund business, and I spoke to them, and they said, so I spoke to the partner, and the partner said, he heard the idea out from me. And he said, yeah, sounds good. So I said, okay, when do you want to see them? Maybe a couple of weeks? Because I thought it must be very busy. No, I'll see them tomorrow. So you know that when the idea is good, people, immediately. So they obviously cleared the table and everything else. It's good, so we want to see it immediately. Because it sounds interesting to us. So I sent across these people to them, and they made the pitch, whatever it is. And I called them 3 days back. And asked them, saying, what happened? They said, the idea is good, team is lukewarm. So I said, what went wrong? Because I said, they have the qualification, they seem to have the thing. He says, there's just no fire in the team. And it came across as very, it's as if they think, they're doing this more like a job. And they're really not committed. We couldn't see that. So the idea is great, they have been a different team, we would have funded it immediately. And believe me, when you believe in something, it shows in your eyes, it shows in the way you speak, it shows in the passion, it shows in the tone of your voice, it sort of just emanates from you. And conversely, when you don't, it again shows. And you intuitively respond to somebody who believes. This is why if you look at all the religious guys, why are they able to get such large followings in India? I think because they convey that. And they believe in, whether right or wrong, they believe very strongly in whatever they do. So remember, therefore, belief comes through. It sort of just permeates the atmosphere. So have that belief. Because without that belief, you will never get funded. Or you'll get funded by a poor funder, which will be even worse. Right? So I think the first step to getting funded is really having belief in your idea. the second step is really understanding what your product is and what the environment is. Let me give you another example. So this entrepreneur I met about a couple of months back was doing an app, interesting app, and nice guy. So he came through a friend of mine, so I spent some time with him. So he was, and it's a nice, good gifting app. So I spoke to him, where do you think you require all your customers from? And what is the hypothesis that we get so many people? So I said, you know, a lot of them will come to Facebook. I said, great, sounds good. Facebook is very interesting acquisition medium today and working very well for large companies. So how does the math work for your business? So then I realized when I asked him two, three questions, he didn't know how many people are on Facebook in India, what the conversion ratios are running for large companies, what kind of cost is involved in, you know, acquiring customers from. So the problem is when you approach somebody, you automatically, you know, so in my mind, my interest fell. Saying if the guy has not done his homework and he expects you to actually then do the homework and teach him, that's not done. So therefore, make sure that you do your homework well. Understand your environment, understand what the target market size, understand what's happened internationally, understand where the model works, understand what kind of constraints does it have, understand what are the equivalents of the model, what costs are there, what businesses have been built, what is the regulatory framework, what is the financing, you know, track record. Understand all that, and then all of that is data available in the public domain. So it's just a matter of spending time. Don't turn up straight out of bed without doing any homework. You may have the greatest idea, nobody's going to listen to it. Because they'll ask three questions and the guy does not ask you sensible, intelligent questions, walk away. Because then you know that he himself doesn't know enough. So therefore, the best guys in the VC funding business are extremely astute, very sharp. They've seen hundreds of startups. They invest in 1 out of 100. They have seen they have a huge track record. So they're able to spot when you've done your homework, whether you believe in your idea, whether you know what you're saying very, very quickly. And that's the reason a lot of people get turned down. They don't even realize it, why they got turned down. They say, oh, that guy, stupid guy, didn't understand my idea. It's not that he didn't understand your idea. He just didn't think you'd done your work a lot of times. And he won't tell you that, obviously. He doesn't want to make an enemy out of it. So he'll going to politely say, no, it doesn't fit into our investing philosophy. Or say, it's too early for us, or it's too late for us. Or he'll give you some excuse which is very bland. He won't tell you anything. But it could be half the time ideas get turned down because the team is not done enough work. So do your homework before you go and pitch. The third thing is, ideally, in any startup, demonstrate. When I say demonstrate two things. Demonstrate a product. Don't go with a PowerPoint and ask for, you know, funding. Rare cases you might, if your idea is very powerful, but most cases you're doomed to, very slim chance to succeed. The more you're able to demonstrate, the higher the chances that you'll succeed. So demonstrate a product at least, which is built out so they can relate to it. Or demonstrate product market fit. What I mean by product market fit is demonstrate early users, see how your users will come, why they've come, what do they love of the service, what they're saying. And demonstrate the attraction. If you do that, you'll find that the chances improve remarkably. Because people love the fact that, you know, there are customers adopting it. Because the new ideas, nobody knows whether it's going to work or not, right? You may believe in it, but the other guy who's funding it doesn't have any clue. A lot of times they're not able to make those calls. Therefore, you have to present them with compelling evidence. So demonstrate, and I think that's extremely important. Demonstrate the product or product market fit. And therefore, also when you make a pitch, the other thing I would advise, and again this is basically diligence meaning working hard, is make sure that you make your pitch, look at great presentations, see how they're made for business, what kind of, how many slides they should have, what structure should have, how much should be visual, how much should be auditory, how much should be written content on the slide. Practice your pitch, get advice, go through 10 iterations. It takes 10, 15 iterations to make a good pitch, even for me. If I'm making a pitch to an investor, I go through, and I'm still doing it today because I keep raising money, and I go through tremendous amount of practicing internally to other people before I actually go to pitch. Because you have to get it right. You have the 10, 15 minutes. It actually gets decided in the first 10, 15 minutes, largely, even if it's 1 hour later. Right? So therefore, you have to make sure that you make that impression. And that the guy will say, okay, fine. This is an idea I want to buy. So make that practice. It takes a lot of practice. It takes a lot of working on your communication skills, on what you're saying on your slides, how you do it, what's your body language, all of it. What questions you answer, how you answer, what answers you have. all that comes through. And therefore, practice, 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 that doesn't happen. So it's a lot of hard work pitching. Get your basics right before you want to go in there.
Would you like to touch upon big work and funding? Like, how did you, who are your investors?
So we got funded very early when we started, and I think in case of Big Basket, I think we're lucky that we've gone through a successful culmination the first time around. So obviously it makes it easier. Investors recognize the fact that this team has done this before. They're more likely to be cohesive, they're more likely to understand and scale up the business faster. So it always helps. But the first time around, again, I think we got funded because we got funded very quickly actually. Our entire funding happened over a weekend and over a phone call. The first round of funds that we ever raised. And I think that happened because of the team's track record. And again, you'll find that most people really think, what is the track record? When investors invest, they will go back and dig back into your career to see what you've done. You'll go and talk to your old friends, they'll talk to your old boss, they'll go and talk to old colleagues in the companies that you work for 3 years back, 5 years back, 10 years back, to figure out what kind of person you are. Right? And they'll check all that. And they will check with your HR to figure out what kind of career graph you have, how successful you've been. They look for all that before they make an investment. So there's a fair amount of investment diligence that goes on before they actually invest in it. So in our case, therefore, they probably went and checked and told us, they went and checked with the employer, checked everybody to figure out what kind of people are they, did they work hard, have they done well, are they intelligent, are they leaders within the company itself. And all that matters, and all that contributes to. So even if you want to do a startup somewhere in the future, make sure that you do well in your whatever jobs that you take. Don't assume that you'll coast along for 5 years and then suddenly become a startup star. It doesn't happen. You have to do well everywhere to be successful in life.
So let's talk about competition and how to tackle them. So maybe in your same space or people from the different space would be your competition. So is there anything you would like to touch upon competition and how to tackle?
Startups should not worry about competition, again like I said about marketing in the initial phase. I think focus on, but having said that, don't be completely oblivious to what's happening in the market. Don't go and build what somebody else is doing. Do exactly the same thing, it's okay. I never knew what was happening. That's ignorance. And ignorance is not, it's maybe bliss for you, it's just a long-term recipe for disaster. So make sure that you understand what's happening in the market, but don't worry too much about especially in the initial phase. Focus on really building a good product, focus on user experience, focus on what needs to be done, and competition will take care of itself. And I've seen this again and again. If you build a great product, and Flipkart is a very good example of that, I don't think you really worry about who is doing what. And just focused on building a better product and better experience, and I think that demonstrates one reason why they're able to stand up, even to Amazon and take their pants off, even today. Right. Even today, I think Flipkart delivers a better experience than Amazon does. And Amazon still has a long way to go before they match Flipkart's experience. So that's the key issue, and it's not that any of the leaders are and the other thing is never be overawed by competition. If you're going into business where you think there's a large competitor, don't worry about it. If you focus on your customer experience and really get at this thing, you will be able to handle any competition that comes. There's nothing which stops you from doing that. And therefore, whether it's an Amazon, whether it's any of the large companies, it is not that they have perfected and they have a the rest of your life, they have sort of hold on all customers. It doesn't work like that. If you deliver a superior product, customers will stay with you and they will come back to you. So don't worry about competition, honestly. And just focus on your product and user experience.
So tell us something about the industry trends as an entrepreneur as a businessman yourself. So what are the industries, which industry do you think has a future?
I think that it's just a very hard thing to do and sit and pontificate about the future. And I wouldn't therefore take any calls on what's happening across broad spectrum of the industries. The good thing about India is I think we're at a confluence of time and demographics where this is probably the best time, and probably from now till the next 5-10 years, is probably the best time to be a startup. It's a lot of things happen. For example, take Europe today. Europe is not an easy place to do a startup today. Very, very difficult. extremely difficult. There are very small, a few areas that I would say, probably internet being one of them, internet services, being one of them, which is really a good industry to be in. But otherwise, it's a tough business, a tough place to be started. So it's not true in India. You can be a startup selling from, selling groceries, selling food, selling something else, providing a service. And there are multiple things that you can do, all of which have a potential and ability to become large businesses. And the reason for that is we have one of the youngest populations today. We have one of the fastest growing economies in the world. We are an economy which is seriously underdeveloped and a lot of basic services and products. So that opportunity is there. So if you combine this, it's not only just the internet space, e-commerce or online services or apps which are really a growth story. You can be in healthcare, you can be in education, you can be in construction. And I know people in each of this world, there are hundreds of startups happening in construction today. You'll be surprised. So the oldest, probably one of the industries which needs to be disrupted in India, in any case. It's the most important and the industry which offers the poorest experience to customers. And they spend the maximum amount of money for it. Right? Today, I don't think you can say a single developer and say this guy will deliver on time, or will deliver to the specs that have been given, or has a great reputation and can execute product, and give me all documents, everything on time. And some of the best builders are customers of volunteers' experiences. So, therefore, each of these businesses you can actually build startups and really. So, therefore, there is no single area I would really think you should worry about and say, okay, this is seems more promising than the others. I'm finding startups across. The issue is really, I think, understanding what is the customer need, defining that clearly, and building the product for that. If you're able to do that, I think that is good enough. And it doesn't have to be online or e-commerce. I think online and e-commerce and all the online services take a disproportionate amount of weight of the media today. And therefore, a lot of people think that's the only way to go. So I keep seeing hundreds of people getting into the next e-commerce business or the next online app or the online service or the next online copy of some successful business in the US. It's not true. There are enough opportunities across other sectors and probably better opportunities. But this is probably the best time to do it. Starting now to the next, or I mean, it's been for the last 5 years to the next 10 years, I think this is probably the best time. I read a quote from Dave McClure. Dave McClure is the guy who launched the 500 startups. And he said, he said, only a fool will not invest in India over the next 10 years. The kind of growth that you'll see in India, not going to see anywhere else in the world. And so somebody like him was sitting in the US, and he says, and he was actually talking to US investors and saying, these guys don't understand what's happening in India. And they're not investing in India, and they don't even understand what the market, what's happening in the market, but all the growth is really going to come out of India. I said this 2 or 3 days back. So there is a significant potential in this country, and I think the idea is really to, if you can find a great idea and work with it, you will build something which is successful.
Sure. So we'll be up to the audience now for a few questions, but before that, I would like to ask one last question from my end. So what are the myths about entrepreneurship in India? So I'm sure you have talked myths about entrepreneurship in your talk. But is there any top myths about entrepreneurship or something? Something which people really think it's great to start up the business, but when we get in there, we realize that it is not what we thought of.
Worry too much about, one of the big ones about entrepreneurship is, and I also kept saying it right through, you have a great idea. It doesn't matter what your idea you started, sometimes just becoming an entrepreneur gives you an idea. So let me give you an example, and I'll take a bigger example. Take Sandy for instance, what did they start with? They were a group on loan, right?
Yeah.
And they saw an opportunity and moved their entire business to becoming a marketplace. And they are one of the largest e-commerce businesses now, not in India, across the world. So sometimes you get opportunities. We started as an online business in 1999. What did we finally become? We became actually a physical store. And so therefore, that may have sounded like a great idea, but eventually what worked was completely different. So sometimes you evolve as you go along. And I think it's important to remember that. So one of the biggest myths of entrepreneurship is that people know what they are going to do. And that's the idea that they have. Sometimes it does, sometimes it does not. It changes into completely different things. And that's good. You learn along the way, figure out where the opportunity is, and maybe the original idea was not really the great one, you found something which was equally good and move along. And that happens all the time. You'll be surprised at how many successful startups started with a completely different idea before they became successful. And legendary, you know, stories about that. So that's one. So don't get stuck up saying what happens if this idea fails. Hopefully you'll find something else which will work. The second two I talked about before, I think, and second, the most important thing, most people get daunted by entrepreneurship saying, I don't know marketing, I don't know technology, I don't know, I have a great good idea, but I, how the hell will I don't know logistics, I don't know, you know, all this stuff. You can learn anything. And I've realized this, doing this multiple career changes in my life, and through multiple businesses that have been, you can learn just about anything. As long as you're prepared to put in that effort and have the right mindset, you can. So,
I work in marketing with Marky. So you talked an interesting thing about product market fit, right? So speaking specifically about Big Basket, I would like to understand from you is how many cities, markets in India are mature enough for this kind of product right now? And what are your growth aspirations for the next 5 years? Would you wait for the markets to mature here in India, or would you like to go international?
So
sir,
I think, let me take the, if you look at the current product that we have, it's probably good for all the urban markets in India, so let's say top 10, 12 cities. But our product is also evolving. So I would guess with the evolved product, we could possibly serve every tier 1, tier 2 market in India. So that's really the scope of the business. I'm not going to be a rural marketeer. Very unlikely that that's going to be any part of the component in the current scheme. So that's not the market that we serve. So we typically be a tier 1, tier 2 market. Kind of company. It supplies all the tier 1 markets. About internationally, that's something which we see that there's a lot of synergy in terms of what we've done at the back end and in terms of what we learned about our customers and all the technology that we have. But the markets in the international, if you look at other markets, the merchandise mix, the way the market functions from a front end in terms of customer preferences, those are things we don't know sitting here. We need to figure out, while we have thought about looking at international, we need to ourselves figure out what's the model that we should adopt. Should we work with other partners? Should we do it ourselves? And should we build a team to understand the market and then do it? So that is something we may do. It's not something that we ruled out. We are quite actively actually looking at it. But when and how we do it, I don't have an answer to it. You need to learn that.
One question back, then we'll start.
The question is, so when we're pitching to the angel investors, do they have reservation about when we're saying that we are given an idea but don't expect returns for at least 3 or 4 years? Because in the time, just believe in the idea, because they are also the investors and they are also investing in money. They'll expect returns at some point of time, maybe earlier rather than later. So how do you convince them? Is it easy or difficult in that point?
No, I think angel investors don't expect returns for some time. Otherwise, you shouldn't be angel investors. That's what I'm telling you. But I keep telling engine investors saying once you put the money, forget about it and assume it's lost. Because good chance it is. So I think, so don't assume that angel investor expects a return in 2 or 3 years. If he does, then you're talking the wrong guy. Run away. Then you're only creating headache for yourself. There's no business can start returning capital and startup in 2 or 3 years. See, that's not the problem. I think what you need to figure out is they will believe in your idea. So angels will believe in your idea and may go by that. It depends on. So find the right angel. Find somebody who is going to be with you for the next 5 to 7 years. So make sure that somebody can add value and not going to jump on their head 2 years later and say, where is my money? And start filing lawsuits against you saying, yes, took my money and disappeared. All that sort of stuff. So just be careful.
An interesting question. In the era of now where we are facing a decision, basically our analytics and our technology and oriented decisions, so how do you think gut feeling has a prominence as far as entrepreneurship is concerned? Because in the time, as our past is reflected, entrepreneurship is based on our gut feeling, the decision and the riskiness. So in the era of data analytics and those, has it lost its prominence?
No. So now you're better off. So now you can test your gut feeling. That's the biggest advantage you have. It's a combination of gut feeling. But remember, analytics can't answer all your questions. The myth that analytics will give you an answer for everything, and therefore the moment you have analytics, you'll be cracked and you're falling behind. It's not going to tell you what your reason of existence is. It can't answer a lot of questions, don't worry about it. I think it's always a combination of gut feeling and analytics.
We have so far. to one, where you hold the inventory and you do the logistics. But in a marketplace, it's like, you know, you have many suppliers and there's like more chaos. Or how do you see it?
Well, it depends on what kind of products that you're selling and what kind of service expectation the customer has. So, for example, if I'm selling a TV, I want to have as many products by suppliers as I can, and I want it all over the place, so I can't, otherwise I have to build inventory in every place. It becomes difficult to start. Whereas, and therefore, there the customer doesn't expect to be delivered the same way. Doesn't care if you buy, he doesn't buy one day, he's buying variety of time, he's not buying one shirt, one television, one book, and say all three should come well. Customer does not have an expectation. Whereas if I go look at grocery, the customer says, you know, you can't ship my atta one day, send the soap the next day, third day I'll send the oil, we'll run away. Anyway, the jokers. So you can't even do that in grocery. You have to put everything together and has to be delivered. So that's a requirement from a customer standpoint. So it, the model is dependent on what your customer expectations are, what category you are.
Sir,
your last question.
Sir, you spoke about that the luck favor only when you try multiple things and you might fail in something. So from your personal experience, anything that you have tried and that has not, you know, came out as you thought of?
First, which is an online business, you can even have the time. So you obviously paid. And all our investors lost their money. So it is not, and we have to some really tough times. So it happens all the time. I have multiple such examples. We paid at many times. So it's not the only one.
One last question. This is the first time that you have been a startup and it's like a hyper-mental marketing and stuff. How this online marketing works? Online people give more discount than what's the market price. They sell less than the market price. Yet they make so $1 million. How does it work?
The idea is really, can you build a large enough customer base? So at some point in time, because the combination of base and the combination of this kind of merchandise that you have, on average, you're able to be profitable for customers. That's really the idea. None of them are there yet. So this is a long way to go. And it looks like Amazon themselves, even the US seems to still be going a long way to go. So therefore, this is not one saying how it will pan out. But it remains to be seen, therefore, how it will evolve and what customers are going to pay. The Indian hypothesis is a little stronger because it's built on availability. So if you look at tier 2 markets, tier 3 markets, a lot of stuff which is available, let's say, in urban metro, just for distribution and supply chain efficiency is not available. And therefore, a lot of they are able to deliver this. And in those places, they're going to deliver the same cost. Without they being lower than market price, you still find buyers. So I think that's the hope. At some point in time, that it will be, you'll not have to discount too much, and you'll still have customers buying from you because of availability, because of range, because of the kind of quality that you have.
So BigBasket acts as a distributor and
charges
the brand to be on your platform?
No, we are retailers. Retailers don't charge the distributor and sell them. The other way around. They sell at a price first and the market and sell on them. We are very marginal amount.
So,
Mr.
Vipul Parekh,
thank you
very much for
your
time. So we are done with this and thank you very much.
Thank you very much for coming here.
Thank you.